Let me start the new topic now, that is the specific heat. Okay, so specific heat means, so to understand the specific heat, okay, so let me get one formula, okay, to derive that formula or to get that formula. Okay, so let me make some fine experiments here, some make some observations here. Okay, so observation number one is, now as a word says, is a specific heat, it is heat only. Okay, so what is heat? Heat is nothing but a form of energy which is given to a substance to raise its temperature. Obviously, we call it as heat. Okay, so let me take delta Q. Okay, I call it as some amount of heat. Okay, so let me take amount of heat given to a substance. Let me measure it in terms of delta Q. Okay, so let me make some observations here. Okay, so observation number one is, let me take two different materials, two materials. Okay, so let me assume that their mass are same. Okay, if I take this one as 1 kg, the mass of the second substance is also 1 kg. Okay, so now the experiment is, okay, if we assume both having the initial temperature of 300 Kelvin. Okay, now the observation is, see, supply some amount of heat, okay, in such a way that the substance one, whose initial temperature is 300 Kelvin, so it goes to some 303 Kelvin. That means raises the temperature by 3 Kelvin. Okay, and in the second case, having the same mass 1 kg, but its initial temperature is 300 Kelvin. So supply certain amount of heat. Okay, here is also a supply, certain delta Q. Okay, so such that this time this 300 Kelvin becomes 310 Kelvin. That means here in this case, you are raising the temperature by 10 Kelvin. Okay, so obviously we can say that in the second case, you require more amount of heat. Okay, reason is, in the first case, you have to supply certain amount of heat in such a way that its temperature increases by 3 Kelvin. But in the second case, it is the 10 Kelvin. So you have to supply more heat to the second case to raise this temperature by 10 Kelvin. Okay, therefore, I can say that the amount of heat. Okay, so delta Q, the amount of heat given to the solid is directly proportional to change of temperature. Okay, so if you require more change of temperature, then you have to supply more amount of heat. Okay, now let me go for observation number two now. Okay, in the observation number two, again, let me take two different materials, the material number one and the material number two. Okay, so both are having the same initial temperature, 300 Kelvin. So this time is also 300 Kelvin. Supply heat delta Q. Okay, in such a way that, okay, in such a way that the temperature increases by 310 Kelvin in the both the cases. Okay, so same here. So delta T. So 300 should become 310 Kelvin. Therefore, we have to change this temperature by 10 Kelvin by supplying the heat. In the second case also, 300 Kelvin. Supply some amount of heat such that its temperature changes by 10 Kelvin. But the differences in the last case, we have taken mass of the both substance are same. Okay, so I have taken some 1 kg. This time, let me assume that their masses are different. Okay, the mass of the first substance is 1 kg and the mass of the second substance is 2 kg. Okay, so again, we can directly say that here it is 1 kg, here it is 2 kg. The raise of the temperature is same in the both the cases, but in the second case, it requires 2 times that of the heat which is used in the first case. Reason is, its mass has been doubled. Okay, are you getting me? Your mass has been doubled, your mass has been increased. So more is the mass you require, more is the heat supplied. Therefore, from based on second observation, I can say that this delta Q is depends on mass of the substance. Okay, it depends on mass of the substance. Okay, now these two observations we can do in our day-to-day life. Okay, if you have small bowl of water, to raise the temperature we require less water. Okay, so if the bowl is large, then you require more amount of heat to raise its temperature. So directly we can say that the delta Q, the amount of heat given to the body, it depends on two quantities. One depends on mass of the body. Okay, one depends on mass of the body, mass of the substance, and second depends on the change of temperature. If you require more change of temperature, then you have to supply more amount of heat. Okay, so they are directly proportional. Okay, as you know that when the quantities are directly proportional, we make them equal by taking certain proportionality constant. Okay, let me take some proportionality constant as S. Okay, so where is this S? Is proportionality constant. So I can write delta Q is equal to S into M into delta T. Okay, so where is this proportionality constant according to mathematics? Okay, in the mathematics, when quantities are proportional, to make them equal, they are taking certain proportionality constant. But in physics, we got some problem here. Okay, the reason is, see, delta Q depends on M, it is understood. Delta Q depends on delta T, it is also understood. This time, the delta Q depends on some constant it is. Okay, so we have to discuss about this constant. Who is that constant? Okay, where is this constant comes from? Okay, I go to the same observation. Okay, again I am going to repeat the observation number one and observation number two. So again, let me take this time two substance having same mass. Okay, let me say that both are having the same mass, 1 kg and 1 kg. The temperature change is also same. If you take 300 kelvin, so the final temperature becomes 310 kelvin. So it is also 300 Kelvin and here is the temperature, it becomes 310 Kelvin. In the both the cases, the temperature seems also same. Okay, now the same question, whether they require same amount of heat or different amount of heat. From these two observations, you can say that they require same amount of heat. Reason is the mass is same, the temperature is, difference is also same. Okay, but I am adding something now. Okay, I am saying that now these two materials are different. Okay, so let me take one is copper. Okay, one is copper and let me take the second one is a stone or some aluminium or something like this. Okay, so now now the same question, whether it requires the same heat or different heat. Obviously this requires different heat because the materials do not absorb heat in the same manner. Okay, if you take wood and copper, okay, so the wood and copper, so you know that copper conduct easily, whereas this wood doesn't conduct easily. The absorption of heat is not same for all the substances. They are different for different substances. Therefore we come to the conclusion that now this, where this S is called a constant, it depends on what? It depends on nature of the substance. Now this S depends on nature of the substance. Now this is a constant, very interesting. This is a constant and that constant depends on nature of the substance. Okay. So whenever we are getting such kind of constant which depends on nature of the substance, it is most important in physics. Reason is, okay, we can identify the material. Okay, by using this constant, because it's constant for a material. Therefore, if the material is unknown, by getting this factor, we can, okay, identify which type of material, which nature of the material like that. Okay, therefore, we should focus on this term S it is. Okay, so let me find how to find S here. Okay, based on this experiment, observations. Okay, so we can study S. Okay, what is S? What is meant by S? Simply, I can say that S is nothing but delta Q. S is nothing but delta q. Okay, it is true. Yes, it is true. If I take mass as 1 and delta t as 1. If I take unit mass and unit change in temperature, then we can say that based on this formula, we can write delta q is equal to s. Okay, so as we are following the SI system, here mass means it should be 1 kg and the change of temperature is taken as 1 Kelvin, then I can say that delta Q, what is delta Q? It is the energy. What is the S unit of energy? Joule. So S is equal to delta Q. That means S has the same physical quantity as that of the delta Q. Because delta Q is equal to delta S. What is delta Q? Delta Q is heat. Therefore, what is S? S should also be, we should call it as heat only. It should have the unit of joule. Okay, therefore the S is nothing but heat only. Delta Q is equal to S means what? S equal to delta Q. That means what? Delta Q is heat energy. Therefore S is also an heat energy. Okay, but S is specified. It is not, what is delta Q? Delta Q is amount of heat given to a substance. Okay, whatever may be, it may be the quantities, whatever may be. Okay, but this time S is not a general quantity, it is not a general form of energy. S is equal to delta Q. Now this condition is S is equal to delta Q. It is possible only when you need to take mass as 1 kg and temperature as 1 Kelvin. That means you are specifying. Okay, S is an heat, no doubt, but it here specifying. It is heat given to a substance. Yes, it is correct. It is heat given to a substance. The substance should have a mass of 1 kg and its temperature should be changed by 1 Kelvin. Then I call that amount of heat as S. Therefore, you are specifying. Therefore, I call this S as specific heat. So this is nothing but specific heat. What is specific heat? Very simple. Specific heat is nothing but a heat. It is a heat. It is the amount of heat given to a substance. For what? For having a mass of 1 kg to raise its temperature by 1 Kelvin. Therefore, I can say that what is specific heat? Specific heat is nothing but amount of heat given to a substance. Given to a substance amount of heat given to substance of mass 1 kg to raise its temperature temperature by 1 Kelvin. Okay, now that quantity, that amount of heat is called specific heat. Okay, are you getting? Okay, so therefore S is nothing but delta Q divided by M into delta T. So S is equal to delta Q when M is as M as 1 kg and delta T is 1 Kelvin. Okay, and what is the S unit of specific heat? The S unit of specific heat can be written as, what is the S unit of heat energy? Joule. What is the S unit of mass? Kg. What is the S unit of temperature? It is Kelvin. Therefore, S unit of specific heat can be written as joule per kg into Kelvin. Okay, so as I already said that the S is an specific heat, it depends on nature of the substance. Okay, so we can easily find the specific heat of any material. Okay, if you take 1 kg of copper, take 1 kg of copper. Okay, so what is specific heat? Supply certain heat delta Q. Okay, delta Q such that if the temperature, initial temperature is 300 Kelvin, if the temperature after supplying heat, if the temperature become 301 Kelvin, so that amount of heat given to the copper is nothing but the specific heat. Okay, so same for, if you want to find the specific heat of an aluminium, take 1 kg of aluminium, supply a certain amount of heat to aluminium in such a way that if the temperature changes by 300 to 301 Kelvin, then again you call that heat as the specific heat. okay, and this amount of heat given to the 1 kg of copper to raise the temperature by 1 Kelvin is different from that of aluminium. Okay, therefore by knowing this value we can identify that materials. Okay, I'm giving certain example for, okay, so I'm giving some specificate of certain substances so that you can identify that materials in future by measuring their specificate. Okay, so we have some list here, please. So first one is aluminium. Aluminium, the specificate of an aluminium is 900, okay, joule per kg Kelvin. That means if you are getting specificate as 900, that means what? The given material is an aluminium. Okay, if you take the carbon, okay, so if for the carbon is something around approximately 506 joule per kg per Kelvin. That means if the specificate is 506, that means it is carbon. Copper, you can see that for the copper it is 386 joule per kg Kelvin. Okay, if you take 1 kg of copper to raise the temperature by 1 Kelvin, how much of heat is required? It requires 386, but for the aluminium it requires 900. Okay, so who conduct more? Definitely the copper conduct more. Okay, because for the 1 Kelvin change, the copper requires only 386 joule, but for an aluminium it requires nearly 900 joule. Okay, so the highest is for, if you look at the okay, so it is given in a book. So lead is given, silver is given, mercury it is 140, ice it is 2060, and highest is for water. Okay, in the nature the specificity is highest for water, that is equal to 4186 joule per kg Kelvin. Okay, that means what? For water, if you want to raise 1 kg of water by 1 Kelvin, you require a heat of 4186. But whereas for copper, what is the energy required? The energy is 386 joule kg into Kelvin. Therefore, in day-to-day life, okay, we observe this phenomena. Okay, so if you want to heat an, okay, if you require some boiling water, if you want to heat the water, okay, what you do? You take some container. Let me assume that the container is made up of copper. Okay, so in that copper container, okay, so you have taken some water. This is water. Okay, when you supply the heat energy, okay, to this container, so you can see that now there are two substances. Now one is copper, second is water. Okay, so if you supply certain amount of heat energy, you can clearly see that the container become hot compared to water. Okay, so if you touch the container, it is difficult to touch the container because it is too hot compared to water. The reason is very simple. Okay, so if you look at the data here, so 1 kg, okay, if it is the 1 kg of water, it requires larger energy, 4186, to raise the temperature by 1 Kelvin. Whereas in case of copper, if you take 1 kg of copper, you require only 386 joule to raise the temperature by 1 Kelvin. Okay, so if the heat energy is 386 joule, okay, then the copper temperature increases by 1 Kelvin. Okay, whereas when the heat energy becomes 4186 joule, the water temperature increases by 1 Kelvin. That means when it reaches the 4186, let me take approximately some 10 times that of the copper. So when it is 4186, the temperature of the copper raised to approximately 10 Kelvin and the temperature of water raised to 1 Kelvin. Okay, therefore this is the reason why different materials get heated to different temperatures even though you are supplying same amount of heat energy. It all depends on the specific heat. So therefore the specific heat is the characteristic of an substance. Okay, by determining the specific heat we can identify the material. Okay, so but if we go to find the specific heat of gases, then this is quite interesting because the behavior of the gases is somewhat different from the behavior of solids and liquids, because that expansion or other things, it is very large, and other intermolecular force, whatever, maybe some discussion. So they are quite different from the solids and liquids. Therefore, in case of gases, you have to specificate. Okay, so solids and liquids, they have the unique specificate, but if you go for the gases, they have to specificate. The reason is, okay, before that one, so what is meant by specificate? The specificate is nothing but the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 kg of material by 1 Kelvin. We call that quantity as specificate. Okay, so when we raise the temperature, now if you take a solid material or liquid material, okay, having a 1 kg, okay, so what is meant by specificate? You are supplying certain amount of heat, delta Q, to raise the temperature by 1 Kelvin. Now that amount of heat, we call it as the specific heat. Okay, so as we already studied the thermal expansion of materials, when you supply the heat energy, as the temperature increases, you study that due to the change of temperature, that due to the increase of temperature, the volume also increases. Okay, so this volume of the material also increases. But in case of solids and liquids, this phenomenon is neglected. The reason is this increase in volume is negligible. Okay, but in case of gases, if it's a 1 kg of gas, if I'm repeating the same experiment, I am supplying delta Q for 1 kg of gas to raise the temperature by 300 Kelvin to 301 Kelvin. Okay, you are supplying the heat, so the temperature increases. As the temperature increases, the volume also increases. But in case of gas, as you observed, that the change in volume is not negligible. Okay, first of all, it is not negligible. The expansion is more is compared to solids and liquids. Okay, so the gases always have heavy expansion compared to solids and liquids, number one. And second one, when they expand, who is the surrounding medium? The surrounding medium is also a gas. Okay, the surrounding medium is also a gas. So when it expand, it has to push the other gases, other air, to gain its volume. Therefore, it exerts a pressure. Okay, when you supply the heat, the change of temperature takes place. The volume increases. As the volume increases, it pushes the other gas to outside. So it makes certain pressure on it. Therefore, to study the expansion, as you know that the change of volume in case of solid, the change of volume, it depends on the temperature, but in case of gases, the change in volume, the volume depends on always both this temperature as well as the pressure. Okay, so we have some real gas equation like this, which gives the relation like this. Therefore, the relation is the between volume, temperature and pressure. Therefore, the volume, it always depends on temperature as well as the pressure. Therefore, this time the definition of specific heat is not so easy as in case of solids and liquids. Okay, because in solids and liquids we have neglected the concept of the pressure and the change of volume like this. But in case of gases, we cannot neglect. Okay, one thing. And second thing, as you know that in case of kinetic theory of gases, okay, so we take it is easy to measure the mass in 1 mole. Okay, 1 mole is nothing, but if you take the Avogadro number of particles, that is 6.02 into 10 raised to 23 number of gas particles, then it is called 1 mole. And the observations and theory, maximum theories, we are considering that 1 mole only. Therefore, in case of gases, okay, so we take the mass as not as 1 kg, we take 1 mole. The definition is same. Okay, so you take, instead of 1 kg, you take 1 mole. Therefore, this particular specific heat, we call it as molar specific heat. Okay, in case of solids and liquids, have taken as 1 kg, therefore a simple specific heat. But if you take 1 mole, then it is called molar specific heat. And the definition is same. Okay, what is molar specific heat? Again, this is amount of heat. required to raise the temperature of 1 mole This time not 1 kg, this time it is 1 mole of substance, mainly it is gases. Okay, 1 mole of substance through 1 Kelvin. Okay, so amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 mole of substance through 1 Kelvin, then it is called molar specific heat. One, and second thing, this time the change of temperature the given to the heat. Okay, so to change the temperature, but this time you have to consider these two quantities, the pressure as well as the volume. Okay, so but you know that. Okay, so we have some Boyle's law is there, we have some Charles' law is there. Boyle's law says that the pressure changes with volume and the temperature is kept constant. Charles says that volume is directly proportional to temperature, provided you have to keep the pressure constant. It is difficult to measure all these three quantities at the same time. Now similarly, okay, so if you want to study molar specific heat, if you're supplying the heat energy, if you want to study the change in volume, then the other quantity pressure, you have to keep the pressure constant. Okay, or if the heat energy is given, if there is some change in pressure, then you have to keep the volume constant. Therefore, you have the two specific heats here. In case of gases, you have two specific heat. One is specific heat, molar specific heat at constant volume. The first one is. Okay, so what is molar specific heat at constant volume? The same definition, amount of heat required to raise the temperature of one mole of substance. One mole of substance through one Kelvin. As I said that, so if you supply the certain amount of heat, there will be a change in both pressure as well as volume, but it is difficult to measure both at the same time. Therefore, you have to keep one constant at one time. Therefore, in first case, we are keeping constant volume. So one mole of a substance through one Kelvin by keeping volume constant, then such kind of specific heat is called molar specific heat at constant volume. Okay, other thing is also possible. Okay, so second is, so this is called CV, molar specific heat at constant volume. Other thing is also possible, that is molar specific heat. Your second one is the molar specific heat at constant pressure. Okay, so what is meant by molar specific heat at constant pressure? The same definition continues. Amount of heat required to raise the temperature of one mole of substance through one Kelvin. So last time you have kept the volume constant. If I keep the pressure constant, then such kind of specific heat is called molar specific heat at constant pressure. Okay, so are you getting? So there are two specific heat for the gases, because the expansion of the gas depends on both pressure as well as the volume. The behavior is different when volume is kept constant or pressure is kept constant. Therefore, we have to study the specific heat of gas in a separate way by using CP as well as the CP. Okay. They are different. CP and CV are different. Okay, so how they are different? Again, let me take one small experiment or small observation to identify that which one is greater, whether CP is greater or CV is greater. Okay, so what is CV? You see, if you take a container, okay, it is completely sealed container. Okay, so in a sealed container, let me take one mole of gas. Okay, so let me assume that their initial temperature is 300 Kelvin. So you are supplying certain amount of heat delta Q, so that its temperature raises by 301 Kelvin. Okay, so this one mole is there. So the raise of temperature is by 1 Kelvin. Okay, you are supplying certain amount of heat. Here the gas is there. Now this is completely filled with an gas. And the volume is constant. So you can directly say that. So this amount of heat given is nothing but molar specific heat at constant volume. Okay, you are supplying heat for 1 mole of gas to raise the temperature by 1 Kelvin. So you can see that it is nothing but molar specific heat at constant volume. Okay, next me. Okay, so here the pressure is not constant, the pressure is increasing. As you supply the heat energy, the kinetic energy of the gas molecule increases. Okay, as the kinetic energy of the gas molecule increases, they collides on the walls of the container. As they collides on the walls of the container, they exert pressure. So pressure is increasing here. Okay, but the discussion is about volume. So you have a fixed container, closed container, therefore the volume of the gas remains constant. Okay, let me go for the second one now. This time again take a container like this. Okay, so you have a container, but this one wall of the container is not fixed, it's a movable. Okay, now this end is not fixed, it can be movable. Okay, just it look like an okay, piston fitted with an frictionless wall like this. So this wall is movable, it is. Okay, same, let me take one mole of gas. Okay, so the same experiment you have to conduct. So initial temperature is 300 Kelvin, so raise the temperature by, so that the temperatures become 301 Kelvin, supply certain amount of heat delta Q. Okay, so this time you have to keep the pressure constant. What is meant by pressure constant? See, before supplying heat energy, okay, now this is a movable piston, it can move in the upward direction or it can move in the downward direction, but when I see that particular position, it is fixed. Okay, it is not moving. So this one is possible only when the inside pressure, okay, so there may be two pressure, one is inside pressure and second one is the outside pressure. So on this piston, PI act on the piston on the upward direction, and P naught is the outside pressure, it act in the wall, the piston in the downward direction. If that pressures are same, okay, if that pressures are same, then that wall is neither moving in the upward direction nor it is moving in the downward direction. Okay, so when you apply the heat, okay, so when you apply the heat, the temperature changes by 301 Kelvin to 300 Kelvin to 301 Kelvin. Okay, so as the heat increases, the kinetic energy of the gas molecule increases. As the kinetic energy of the gas molecules increases, they start hitting the walls of the container. Okay, as they're hitting the walls of the container, the pressure inside the container becomes greater than the pressure outside. Okay, but our experiment is to keep the pressure constant, therefore you have taken a movable piston. It is very movable, it is a frictionless. So okay, so what happens if the PI becomes greater than P naught, then they start moving in the upper direction. Okay, it start moving in the upper direction until again the internal pressure becomes same as that of the outward pressure. Okay, it moves until the internal pressure becomes same as that of the outward pressure. Finally it stops. Okay, as it stops, that means what? The pressure again, it remains constant. Therefore I can say that, so in this case you keep the pressure constant, that is same as that of the outside pressure. Therefore I call this pressure heat as the molar specific heat at constant pressure. Okay, you can see that in the first case you have kept the volume constant, but there is a fine rise in pressure. But in the second case, you are keeping the pressure constant. To keep the pressure constant, it is moving in the upward direction. Therefore, you can see that the volume of the gas has been increased. Okay, so one or the other case, the one has to be changed here. Okay, now discussion is which one is greater, whether CV or CP. Okay, so whether CV is greater or CP is greater. Definitely I can say that the CP is greater. Okay, CP is always greater than CV. reason is, now see here, in the case number one, you are supplying the heat. Okay, you are supplying the heat for 1 mole of the gas to change its temperature. So only one work is there. What kind of work? You are supplying the heat for 1 mole of gas and you are raising the temperature by 1 Kelvin. But in the second case, you are supplying the heat for one mole of gas and you are raising the temperature by 1 Kelvin, the same work. Okay, for an example, if it requires 10 joule of energy, 10 joule of energy, what is 10 joule of energy? You are supplying 10 joule of energy to 1 mole of a gas to raise the temperature by 1 Kelvin. Now, same here. So, you have the 1 mole of a gas, the same gas, and you are raising the temperature by 1 Kelvin. That means you require 10 joule only. You require 10 joule. Okay. But in the second case, some additional work has been done. Okay. In the second case, you have to keep the pressure constant. To keep the pressure constant, the gas has to be pushed this wall in an upward direction. It requires some additional energy to push the container, to push the wall in the upward direction. It requires certain additional energy. Who supplies that energy? Definitely, it should be heat energy only. Okay, so in the second case, the heat energy given to this 1 mole of a gas, okay, it is utilized in two ways. One, to raise its temperature by 1 Kelvin, and second one, it do certain work on the wall so that it has to keep the pressure constant. Therefore, the specific heat, the molar specific heat of gas at constant pressure is always greater than molar specific heat of a gas at constant volume.
Okay, now you can see that the specific heat is different in case when you are keeping the pressure constant and when you're keeping the volume constant. When you take in helium, the specific heat, the molar specific heat of helium at constant pressure, you are getting something around 20.8, and the molar specific heat for helium when constant volume it is 12.5. So you can easily see that this Cp is greater than Cv. Okay, in each case, so the data shows that the specific heat at constant pressure is always greater than specific heat at constant volume.